In this video, we'll look at how we can represent text using nothing but numbers, how encodings and decodings work, and what standards like ASCII and Unicode are. Finally, we'll look into the UTF-8, UTF-16, and UTF-32 encodings. And that's it, let's go. Let's pretend that A is 1, B is 2, C is 3, and so on. Given some text, we can simply replace every letter with its corresponding number. Also, let's say 0 is used for empty spaces between words. And in binary, if we use 5 bits per character, it could look something like this. This process is called encoding. We have just encoded our text into a bunch of numbers. The opposite is called decoding, where we turn numbers back into what they represent. Now, in reality, there are many different encodings used around the world. To be consistent across devices, standards are needed to define which numbers represent which characters. And the first standard we'll talk about is ASCII, which was created way back in the 60s. ASCII stands for American Standard Code for Information Interchange. They decided that uppercase characters start at 65 and lowercase at 97. Here are uppercase A and lowercase A. Both can be represented in binary, of course. And here are uppercase B and lowercase B. If you look at the 6 bit from the right in each number, you'll notice something very interesting. If this bit is 0, we have an uppercase letter, and if it's 1, we have a lowercase letter. Also, the first bits actually are just counting up from 1, just like we did earlier. For A, they are 1, B, 2, and so on. That is convenient if you want to compare the order of characters. As you can see, there are lots of clever little design considerations in this encoding. The whole ASCII table looks something like this. There are numbers for letters, punctuation, empty spaces, and for special meanings like line breaks and stuff. Our maximum value is 127, meaning ASCII uses 7 bits per character. But you probably already noticed that there are some problems with this. What if you're German, like me, and you want to write an A, Ö, Ü, or SZ? Sadly, these are not in the ASCII table. The same goes for French, Spanish, and other languages that require a few additional characters. So, people had to come up with other encodings. Some of these extend ASCII by adding an 8th bit, others are completely unique. Of course, this all falls apart once you get to languages like Japanese, which has 3 systems of writing, one of which has tens of thousands of characters. Such languages had completely different encodings yet again. And this brings us to a big problem. Our computer needs to know which encoding is used for a given text. So you can see how using so many different encodings is not a great solution. Wouldn't it be nice if we just had one encoding for all languages? Well, that's where Unicode comes in. The Unicode standard was started back in the 80s and first published in the early 90s. Its purpose is to provide a standard for text encodings that support a variety of languages. To date, scripts used in pretty much all major languages in the world are supported, and even stuff like emojis are part of the standard. So how does it work? Instead of characters, Unicode has what's called code points. Each of these is either a character, a smaller portion of a character, or some kind of modifier or glyph. And as always, a code point is just a number. The first 7 bits worth of code points are identical to ASCII, making Unicode backwards compatible with it. But it goes on from there and adds all other languages. For example, the A, U, U, and SZ from earlier have their own code points. And the Japanese hiragana A, for example, is 12,353. Korean text, or Hangul on the other hand, has characters for every possible syllable. For example, the syllable sang is code point 49,345. However, each syllable can also be constructed using 2 or 3 separate code points called jamo. Here are 3 of them, which when combined also represent sang. As you can see, Unicode is a little more complex. So how many bits do we use for each code point? The answer is, it's complicated. Unicode has multiple encodings called UTF-8, UTF-16, and UTF-32. UTF-32 is pretty simple. It just stores every code point using 32 bits. That makes it a fixed length encoding, like ASCII, but it consumes much more space. As a result, it isn't used as much as the other 2 encodings. Here we have the dog face emoji, which is code point 1F436 in hexadecimal, or 128,054 in decimal. In UTF-32, we simply store this value as a 32-bit binary number, and that's it. UTF-16 is a variable length encoding. Any code point from 0 to D7FF in hexadecimal is simply gonna use 16 bits of data. Pretty straightforward, we just use 16 bits to store these. For larger code points, we need to encode them a little differently. This time, let's encode the cat emoji into UTF-16. Its code point is 1F431. Here it is in binary. Next, to get it into the correct range, we need to subtract hexadecimal 10000 from this code point. That means we subtract the 17th bit from the right. Here are 32 bits, which we'll write our code point into. But first, each of our 16-bit portions is labeled with a special header. That's 110110 for the left, and 110111 for the right 16 bits. All that's left is to fill the empty bits with our code point. And that's our cat emoji in UTF-16. The same can be done in reverse, of course, to decode the code point. UTF-8 uses anywhere from 1 to 4 bytes per code point. This time let's try and represent the poop emoji, which is code point 1F4A9. In UTF-8, we use special bit patterns as headers that tell us how many bytes are used. If the first byte starts with a 0, it's a single byte encoded code point, which is identical to an ASCII encoded character. 110 indicates that we're using 2 bytes, 1110 indicates 3 bytes, and 11110 indicates 4 bytes. In cases where there are more than one byte used, any further byte is using the header 10. This header indicates a continuation byte. For our emoji, we'll need 4 bytes. That means the first byte uses the 11110 header to indicate the length of 4 bytes. The following 3 bytes use the continuation header 10. Our actual data is then simply put into the remaining empty bits, and that's it. Now you may have noticed that we didn't actually write any bits into the first byte. So why are we using 4 bytes and not 3? Well, if we had used 3 bytes, the first would have had the 1110 header, and there wouldn't have been enough empty bits available to store the emoji. So we had to fall back to using 4 bytes, even though the first one doesn't actually store any data. Now let's use another example that uses only 3 bytes. Here's the hiragana character A again, and here's the code point in hexadecimal, decimal, and binary. This time, we use the 1110 header to indicate that we're using 3 bytes to store the data. And of course, every continuation byte then uses the 10 header. Then we just fill the empty bits with our code point. And again, we can just do the same thing in reverse to decode our code points. Simply read the bits past the headers, and that's your code point. And that's it. Now you know how to encode and decode text using ASCII and Unicode. Of course, there are other encodings out there, and there are many, many more details to the Unicode standard, which we didn't talk about. For instance, the Unicode core specifications contain over 1,000 pages of documentation. What you see here is just a table of contents. It even has sections with details about all the different languages supported. We can't cover all of that even if we wanted to, so I recommend if you want to look for something specific, you just take a look at the specifications. But that's it for now. I hope you learned something, and thank you for watching.